If you're asking who is this guy, so we're gonna use this his company this season. Basically, he will introduce everything, what they do. But the main thing is that it's a company that how you say enhancement performances, stats, analyzing stats with a different way, and he will explain everything about it. So we're going to use them. He's going to be with us behind the scene, and that's it, basically. Done.
Done.
Okay.
Yep. And cook soon. You gonna move?
Yeah. Are you good? Excited. My name is Dan, I'm 48. 40? 48? No, 46 now. Israel, used to be a swimmer back in the days. Israeli champion, went to European champion, stuff like that. Switched to soccer, a footballer. And then I played first division in Israel, then I got a scholarship in the States, and I played 2 years in New Jersey, and then four years I had to it in Connecticut. We won 2 NCAA championships. I played for Tom Lang, coach of the year, for 2 years. And then I did my my degree in psychology. And I did my master's in exercise science, which is all the physical, technical, kinesiology, also mental. The thing about exercise science that you don't take any science aside. Everything together. And my concentration was sports psychology. I studied for a long time. And then I realized that all the stuff we learn about sports psychology is not working for me on the field. Not working to be balanced and to breathe. I always looked for that special gut feeling, that special energy that makes things happen. Not to be good, to be great. And I searched it for a long time, and I tried to make sense, especially in analyzing statistics, when every company became the checking everything, every action, every touch, and we got endless amount of statistics. But in the end of the day, it's tough really to know what is good and what is not that good. Today, most of the players in all sports playing for the agents, playing for stats, because stats can take you to better contract, can get you there. And with times we lost the main understanding of a team concept, of giving our heart to one another, sacrifice for one another, because no one really count, no one pay and count for what heart and soul players do. So even if your heart and your mind is thinking about the team, society will push you to run for your score, run for your statistics, run for stuff that is not really team concept. I start to check hundreds of games that there is a battle between people. And I start all over. I said, I don't care for regular statistics, and I start to check every touch, every bump, and I start to put them in two separate categories. One category, I called it will action. Why will action? Because you need zero talent to do it, to run, right? To fight, to sacrifice, to help a friend. There is no talent. If you're an athlete and you're in a physical good condition and your mind is on the right place and he's your brother and someone beating up your brother, you win. That's it. And the other side is talent. And it's also connected to ego. Now, talent is great. We want talent. But we want talent to play with confidence. When you play with confidence, your talent is shining. When you don't have confidence, your talent is stuck. You dribble, you shot, your focus, suddenly you don't see everything, your focus is narrow, so your performance is down. So we start to measure all the things that people don't measure usually. I tried to invent, what can I do? We went all the way even to bumps. You know, when you're guarding down, every bump we count. Why? Because it's exhausting the other side. It takes energy from the other side. It's fucking up. It's important. And we count. In soccer, we got to 10,000 action. In basketball, it's usually around 400 to 500 action every game. For everyone. So we count it, we break it down, and pretty much around 70% of all the action in basketball got nothing to do with talent. It's only discipline, practice, heart and soul. 70%. And on top of this, whoever win the wheel action, over 90% win the game. Now, of course, if you play against much better team talent, you need to win your heart action in higher percentage. But in the end of the day, it's give us an almost ultimate way to control our behavior and our performance and to control our confidence. So how are we doing it? We're taking all the red action. Why red? Blood. Simple, blood action. And why blue? Because blue is coming to talent. So, assist, points, shots, great. We're playing for that. But there is always a question if you win because you score one basket more or you receive one basket less. And what can we control? So, we're taking all the red action, add the blue action, and we give it a value. We slice it by the minutes, value per minute. Why? Because I want you to control your performance. And I don't want you to be concerned with statistics and stuff you can control. If coach decide not to let you play, or let you play only 5 minutes, so you can't score 20 points. You can't. So what can he do? You pissed off, you upset, you're taking yourself down. Now he's saying, I'm counting you for every minute you play. So if I played 7 minutes and I did 15 actions and I scored 6 points, that's all I could do. And someone else playing 30 minutes and scored 18 points. Who is better? Who can contribute more? How can you show coach that you deserve more minutes? Say, okay, but you don't think I'm good. You give me 7 minutes. I give you more value per minute than the rest of the team. Can you consider me for another 5 minutes? For another 3 minutes? And in this way, players can really control the performance regardless to how many minutes they get or what scouts thinks or what TV people think. You can control it, and then you can control your confidence. Yeah? So it's a small list, and it's go on, and we can go over it. But wheel action, we start with deflection, deny, contest shot, box out, pick and basket, pick and assist, rebound by itself. Rebound and transition for basket. Rebound and basket. Rebound, basket, foul. Join foul. Foul themselves. Lose balls. Deflection, only deflection. Deflection possession, more points. It's almost like a steal. Steal is one thing. Steal and assist, better. Steal and basket, better. Steal, basket, foul, better. You get more value. So, all those actions are not talking about defense. They're talking about attitude. And it's coming really straight up with what your team is trying to do. The hardest thing in sport, there is always something that you give up. If you play slow, you can play physical.
If you play fast, the intensity, the physical level is a little bit dropping. Right? Like it's a give and take. Over here, you're trying to do both. To fulfill potential, you need to play fast and strong. All the time. So there is no more 34, 35, 37 minutes players for 50 games, for 100 games. No can do. No can do. No, no one will give you those minutes for like 50, 60, 70 games. So our ego need to calm down a little bit, and our thoughts of fulfilling ourselves is need to be a little bit higher, because you demand this year or in the past few years to do the hardest thing in sport. Fast and physical. Smart and physical. So it's take a lot of focus. It's not like Indian people that flying all over the place. You're thinking what you're going to do in the offense, and then what you're doing in rebound offense, how you stretch, you're thinking about everything. But it's demand out of you a very high intensity, focus and physical. And obviously the combination usually coming with confidence. You see guys, when we don't have confidence and I steal a ball, usually I will hold it because I don't want to save it. I'll give it to the point guard. I'll go. I'll take rebound, I'll curve in, and I'll go. When we have confidence, we want to push it forward. When we have high confidence, high, steal, and all the way. And the punishment. But confidence, that's the tricky thing we're going to learn maybe today, is not consistent. Confidence is a moving thing during a game and during a season. Confidence in sport is only if we feel we can handle the challenge. You know, I'm playing somewhere, I say, yeah, I got him. I feel I got him. My confidence is high. But if I feel he got me, my confidence is low. So if my confidence is low, and I'm by myself on the 3 points, and my confidence is low, and I don't feel good, should I take it? Shouldn't I take it? A lot of decisions need to be regarding the confidence we feel in that same moment. So in order for us to control our confidence, we want to bring us to habits that we can control the red action and we can put the other side on stress all the time. Before we're going to see a video of that, I just want to explain to you physiologically what's happening. How are we going to do it? So this model is physical, mental. In my opinion, there is no mental without physical in sport. No. If you can do it, you're confident. You can't do it, you're not confident. Our ego, the talent, ask what in it for me? What do I get? Do I get the point? Do I got the ball? It don't pass me. It didn't pass me. Why didn't it pass me? I was open. They don't play for me. Me. What do I get? The problem with this, it's uncontrollable. No one can control before the game what will be the results of his action in the game. No one can control before the game that you will score 25 points. No one. If the best player in the league guards you, if it's not, you don't feel it today. Many things could happen, and that leads us, when it's uncontrollable, to fear. We're talking bad talk to ourselves, negative talk. We're doubting ourselves. Before games, a lot of times when we stress, we talk to ourselves a lot. Okay? One side, talk to the other. What are the rules? The ego rule, always think like this. How can I give little and get a lot? Always, for everything. And give a little bit, get a lot. A lot of respect, a lot of balls, a lot of the... The other side of our brain, our soul, our heart, thinking the opposite. my input, what I give to my team. Before, again, I'm nervous. I'm asking myself, how many points I score? I say, no. How can I help him? How can I help him? I will help you. I will help you. I will help him. I will touch everyone. I will help only outside of me. What I will give. Then there is no fear coming in. Because no one is afraid to give. And we can control what we want to give. We can't control what we want to receive. So then it's creating excitement. Why do I tell you this? Because when fear coming in, a brain releases a drug that's called cortisol. We start a fight, puff, adrenaline rushing in. Adrenaline rushing in, we sweat, things different, we go to the toilets, we nervous, we cold, we warm, we tired, many things. Adrenaline telling us a war is coming up. Get ready. Okay, excited. But if fear coming in, cortisol are freezing us, which means adrenaline coming in, like warm water, and cortisol freeze the action. Heavy, legs heavy, breathe heavy. So then, a performance is 20% less. Choking. You can fight it, but it's not flowing. When adrenaline coming in, and we think positive, and we think what should we give, because we control what we can give, our brain releases endorphin, dopamine, drugs that releasing us, get us to the flow, to the zone, runner's high, we feeling it. Physically, when cortisol coming in, every hit feel more painful than it is. With endorphin and adrenaline, endorphin, dopamine, we don't feel pain that much. We can take it much higher. So the same person on the same day could be 40% different. Back in the day, they used to say he's a winner and he's a loser. But it's not true. Actually, the people they call losers, the chokers, usually have the highest potential to overlap it. Because it's so competitive nature and they want to do it so much, so sometimes they overthink. But when they get loose, animals, we can control it, we can teach it. We can work. That's why they say, think positive. Talk positive. Pray positive. But if you really don't want to have any fear, pray for your teammates. Pray for the team goals. Pray for your habits that you can control in order to help your team. And then when you don't think of offense and you just get it, it's on a go. Most of the time when we try to imagine offense or skill or who is looking at me, it's almost never happened in the game the way we thought. We try to force what we think. Usually our greatest performance happens when it just happened. You're in the right place, you're in the right place, it's flowing because your mind is not forcing reality. You play the game. You understand it? It makes sense?
Yeah.
So it's always a question of control. If you feel control, we can create good habits, good attitude, and we can control that special 20%. If this team will be able to do it as a team, I think this season will be a great, great season for you guys. I love this team. I love the Czech people over here, and I really like the foreigners who are coming in. I think you high intelligent players, hard worker players, very team spirit players, but the X factor of it, it's that killing mood that everybody in a game day.
Obviously, you need to practice it all the time, and you're not going to hurt each other on practice. But the intensity and the physical should be there all the time. And I feel that it will be extremely, extremely tough to prepare against you. This is not a one-star team. This is a team. Anything could happen. So that's the idea. This is the main idea of what I'm trying to do here. Okay? Let's see an example of that real quick. And maybe it will make sense. And then we'll go for the next thing. Sasha.
It's not working. Sasha, folks. Seriously.
Oh, no, Sasha, just take the whole thing down and open it. Yeah.
Even though the job is not doing, of course, people don't like it. They don't want to do it. But I love what I'm doing. I want to earn my money. I want to earn my respect in the court.
Okay, so we just, some of the action, we talk about throw fouls. And the pride of things, throwing fouls, going charge, moving your body, getting high points for us. Now, we showed Chicago Bulls because everybody thought they were the best offensive team in the world. But actually, they competed between themselves with the best defender in the league. Dennis, Stephen, Rodman, fight between themselves who is the best defender, who sacrificed his body more. So after charge, they used to celebrate. Draw foul and basket. Not only drawing the foul, holding the ball, taking the advantage. Deny. There's a lot of people who think about deny, but deny, you're really hustling. You're really in his face, you're really touching him. Assist, always nice. Office rebound. The thing about Dennis, that he was only 2 meters, and 7 years in a row he was the defense rebounder player of the year in the NBA. So you're thinking, what is it? If not mind and heart and thought about it, it was in his thing. Now all the steals over here start from deny, from deflection, from an action before that. Not clean, only clean steals. Now steal in basket is the ultimate killer. Because after a steal, after a charge, and dropping coming in, your confidence is flying for like 3, 4, 5 seconds and the basket is open up. They started to block a lot. And then they thought about block and possession, block, possession, transition. So people stop making blocks outside and keep them on court. Okay, block possession, usually you have like for 30, maybe a minute, huge advantage on the physical level. Deny that lead to loose balls, lead to transition. OK,
Okay, you see over here, Scottie Pippen was one of the worst three-point shooters. But after a steal, when a dropping coming in, he got a green light from coach to shoot threes. So almost after every steal, he used to take a free. But on a regular game, he wouldn't shoot a lot. His percentage was not good. But Phil Jackson understands the idea that after a big wheel action, your confidence is higher for a short period of time. And that's what we call momentum. And this is usually how they used to close a series. This is the team intensity. Everybody under the basket, everybody touching, hands moving all the time, everybody in. One pointer on Chicago Bulls. They used to get scored around 85, 86 points in a 48 minute game, NBA 48 minutes, which is a very low score. Not many games they won by 120, 130. It was extremely tough to play against them. They took a great pride of fucking you up, getting into your mind. They used to fight. Who will guard the best guy on the other team? You move. No, I'll take it. You go to YouTube and you will find there is a beautiful movie about the Dream Team when they went to play, and then they had to play against Tony Kukoc, who already been drafted to Chicago. Now, Scotty, they didn't renew his contract, so he was pissed off. And all night before, he took it seriously and he told Michael, I'm guarding him the whole game. I'm killing him. He's not touching the ball. Michael tell him, no, I will guard him. And they fight on the bus. Karl Malone, Scotty and Michael fighting, who's going to kill Tony Kukoc? And then they show him that in the first action of the ball, they're waiting for for Tony Kukoc under the basket. They used to walk him all over. They fucked him up. Before he came to Chicago in the same season. Like that mindset to get into people's mind, to earn, to own the heart. It's just a crucial part if you want to be big champions. Always say that it's not agree exactly that you don't need talent for this. Obviously you need talent. Obviously, you need to be smart, you need to know how to sacrifice yourself, you need to... But you mostly, I think, you need to want it. And in today's world, not many players wanted to have a big heart, wanted to be known for it. And when it's their team like that, and that's the mind of a team, it's extremely, extremely powerful. You want to go back to the...
Sasha, track.
What? He's doing it to me on purpose, Sasha.
Purpose?
Like he's holding me back a little bit. Okay, we're going? That's it? Okay, so we just wanna explain the language so it will be easier for you. A basketball game, 200 minutes. To create, right, 5 players, 40 minutes. 200 minutes. A good tempo is around 200 wheel action. So it's an action a minute. That kind of active. And on top of this, there is offense. So studs, strong players, will do around 1.1, 1.2, 1.5, 6. Which means they have high confidence. The confidence is high. and Joffin flying in, their focus is wide, and they can play the game. Like in practice, they have the same counter. Solid is when you can handle your man, you can handle your job, but you still, you fear, you're not really sure, but you can do both things. It's on and off. It's stressful, you can do it. And needed is when you're under the level of the team and you know it in your heart. So many times when you need it, you try to save your moments with offense. You're forcing shots. Say, if I make, say, you give me another 2 minutes. You give me another 5. So it's different mindset. When we need it, we think how not to make mistakes. How not, you know, to make anything bad, and then we can move on. When you're solid, your mind think, for one end, I want to fuck them, and for one end, I don't want to get killed, so it's on and off. You have moments like this, moments like this. You know, you can get pissed off, go to the bench, and then come back, and have a... But when you stud, you see the game from above. You feel good with yourself, and you can see your friend, and you can help each other. And when there is 5, 6 studs on the same place, it's a dangerous thing. Dangerous. And it's controllable. We talked about the minutes. The distribution is not up to any one of us. It's up to the coaches. We can control it, so we don't need to get pissed off about it. We can't take ourselves down because they decide not to play me. I'm a player, I say, coach is the idiot. When they give me 2 minutes, I'm going to kill everybody. I'm going to do 3 VPM, I'm going to show them. Because I can control it. They will see it every game. And if I do it 4, 5, 6, 7 games in a row, I push them to give me more minutes. That's it. And the formation usually is changing. Like we said before. People can play 3, 4, 5 minutes. They feel that it's coming down a little bit. They can go out, give high five, everything is okay, get your breath together, and again. And again, and again, and again, all of a sudden. So we're talking about the value, in the end of the day, that's performance enhancement, because I want to give the players an opportunity to control their faith, to control the team faith. And then you can talk to one another on, you know, with meaning. You can help one another to be great. Now, every person have different skills that is doing good. Some people is better in rebound. Some people better in steal. Some people draw foul real good. Draw foul, they get to the line, they get the other team in trouble. Some people touch the ball. They can touch a lot of deflection, that becoming something. Now, every time that you're getting into the rhythm of the other team, you're messing them up. Think about it. When there is doubt, it's on the side of the ego. You break an automatic move. Let's say I'm getting a ball, I'm shooting. This is my life. But then I'm getting a ball and I'm stuck, and then I'm shooting. Right away I'm thinking to myself, no, there is a negative self-talk. He put himself cortisol, and then it's short a little bit. Think about it. How can NBA players can stand on free throw and make airball? Airball, NBA, how could it be? Full with cortisol. You're doing the same movement exactly, and everything is just a little bit tighter. You understand? And that's what people say, I have a routine. What is a routine? It's a bubble that you put yourself in, and you're doing it all the time, all the time, all the time, and then it's automatic. What's the problem with routine? That no one likes to do it in practice because you don't need it in practice. You're not nervous. In practice, you don't need it nervous. But, so you need to make an artificial thing for a day that there is a lot of press, and then you're coming, and you need to do your own routine. What is a routine? Positive self-talk. And talking about 3 major things to be focused on. Technical. Energetic. And air. So a lot of times, you dribble it,
and you talk positive things, a lot of people can see the kids, can see good things, like much more important than any basketball thing, getting in the right proportion, and getting air that right away take oxygen to the brain and to the body to release the cortisol and to allow endorphin to flow in. So a lot of people taking their time. They breathe until they feel it, they feel their knees, they talk again, they see the line of the ball, and then they're sending the ball to the same line. Over and over and over again. And in practice, they don't shoot more than two shots in a row. Because in a game, you don't shoot more than two shots. So to stand on a free throw and to take 20 shots, it's not good. You need to take two to move and do it again. And do it again. And then everybody can control it. There's a lot of shooters that have a cue before the shot. Me, for example, when I'm a great shooter, I think like 27%. I do like a Hakuna Matata. Okay, so everyone have a cue, can do cues in order to do that. Let's move ahead. I just want to give you an example from a pilot we did a few years back with Maccabi Tel Aviv. They had a very bad beginning of a season. And the budget was 23 in Europe, and Maccabi Tel Aviv always think that they should win every week, every year. And actually, I had a great privilege, just to help a little bit with this, to coach Vlad, but for me, maybe he's one of the greatest, is an example for too many great things to learn from. And let's just see what it was. And this is after like 6 months or 5 months that we worked already, and we explained to Maccabi that they don't have a roster, five that can be top, but 10 players who are willing to sacrifice themselves and see the game different can control the tempo. So Maccabi Tel Aviv did 200 red actions as underdog compared to Real Madrid. It's like 30 actions more that gave them something like 17 or 18 more possessions. Real Madrid played football the game before, the day before the final, because in the semi-final they play against Barcelona, that for everyone that was the biggest final. They beat Barcelona, they went to celebrate, and they came to play because they're much better player than Maccabi. Now, move ahead. And then we want to see, look how simple it will look in the end of the day. We take all the actions, and put them in two categories. The green represent the minute coach gave him. No one can control the green line, only coach. So, nothing. But the red action, if it's in the same line as the minute, solid. If you under, like Smith was over here, you see, like the red is under the line, a little bit needed. Actually, he just had bad knees and David played him like 41 minutes. He's the only one he trusted. Okay, in the end of the, but all the rest of them was stud, Ingles. How many points he scored in the final? You see blue, no points. Ingles are playing in the NBA right now, like for 3-4 years, didn't score 1 point. Still, his contribution was great. He didn't get a lot of minutes, and he gave more than the minute he got. Guy Pliny didn't score a point, but he gave more wheel action than the minute he got, and his karma, his baraka, was good. But the biggest thing in that group was David Blue turned up. David Blue, like his name, is blue. He's a great shooter, he's an unbelievable shooter, strong body, but never visit in the paint. From three to the left. And when we had that change to make 6 months before, Blue said that it was his last season. That's it, he's done. And when you explained them the system, we said, you know what, forget basketball, let's play like in the streets. Like when we play 3 versus 3. No referees, no, let's fight. Don't worry about your shot. Let's just put your heart in. Let's do something that you never did. He was 31 years old. 31, never played defense. Never played under the basket, never used to push.
But when David Blue was break even, you didn't have a weakest link. And he's the best shooter Maccabi had. And then there is something smart that we should learn that, you know, that we different people. I don't know if you remember him, but this is Sofo. Remember Sofo? Greek, heavy man, 2'8", the best player in the world for 2.5 minutes. Seriously, he can't do more than 2.5 minutes. But Sofo think that he's 6'1". He's jumping on the floor, he's pushing, after 3 minutes he's dead. Okay. So David Blatt played with him 4 times, 3 minutes. When he was on the court, they played so far away. When he wasn't on the court, they played. So he played, look at this. He played only 10 minutes. He did 21 red action points, like double the minutes. And on top of this, he had 9 points. Only 10 minutes. MVP of Maccabi. Now, let's watch what happened in Real Madrid. Real Madrid, billion times better players. Okay? But Sergio Yul didn't score a point. Why? He was choking. It's happening. It's happening. You can't really control, but you can control your attitude. But Sergio, his ego was crushed. He didn't score. He talked shit to himself. He killed himself down. He did less and less and less and less. And he played 36 minutes and he did less than what Sofo did in 10 minutes, right? So, needed, Darden, needed, Slaughter was needed. Three players with low confidence. I don't know if you remember, but the last action of the game was that Slaughter lost the ball, just passed him and he lost the ball. Yeah, from one end it's luck, but when you don't have confidence, and it's really low, and cortisol is flying in 7 seconds to the end, shit like this happens. Especially if the other team pushing it to be. Pushing them to be. Sergio, break even there. Break even. Blue and red equal all the time. Perfect player for that level, you know, for years. And you can see who rised up. Yeah, they did perform, but when 3 or 4 out of your stars are not showing up, it's a game breaker. I think if Maccabi played against Real Madrid 10 times, they beat them only once. But that's all that matter. On that one day, to come together, not to worry if how much I score because we can control it, but to know that all of us, what I give, get me excited. We excited to give ourselves to the team. And that's what we will try to measure over here. You want to show that video? Only if you want to, if not. No, it's a technical challenge?
I hope not.
Okay, let's see if we can do it. Okay, so we'll go over just really together to see what he did in that game. Put sound, because it's really good. Luka's decision making, because David talked to him all the time about it. Stop when I tell you, okay? Stop. His first 3, it's a perfect shot for him. Perfect shot. In and out, missed it. No big deal. Second shot, he closed the range to the free throw, usually is a 90% from there. Let's go to his second shot. Never doing it. In and out, unfortunately. Third shot. David Blue, driving in, never doing it, getting a free throw, listen to this. Tuck. You like that sound? Let's keep confidence. That's his first point. Now look at him on defense. I'll count it for you. Bounce, 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 got the point, flying up. Look at him, charge, Ingles charge, deny, possession. David Blue. Bam, don't let him bam, bam, dribble, got the possession. Look at him, under the basket, throwing him down. Slider, okay? 217. Shot, 1 minute to halftime, his first shot.
Obviously, the night before, he wanted to score 40 points, 20 points.
The first make.
The first make. Sorry, first make. Go. Okay, look at him. Challenge, contest, touching. Again, try to contest, contest. Get the point. Back to the basket. On the best point guards, on the best point guards, get him in foul trouble, coming to the line again. Tuck. Tuck. 6 points. Right? 1 minute to the end. Again. Box out, box out, box out, etc. And now the end of the half. Okay, so he made only 1 3 after he built his confidence. He's finished his half with 9 points, but not like he thought. Back to the basket, free throw, 4 points, 3 points. Not like he wanted. He wanted like 3 times. Pa-pam, pa-pam, pa-pam. Shoot him. But he changed his mind. He saw Rudy Fernandez. He took him back to the basket twice. Took Rudy out of the game. 7 minutes while he's sitting out because David Blue put him in three fouls. Travel. So I'm showing it to you just to explain to you that anyone can do it. Even if it's out of your character, like you think it's not in your character, it's in your character. And if a team see it together and build it together, in my opinion, you can control your fate and you can do something unbelievable this season. Unbelievable. What the Czech guys on the national team did, I think, put belief that you can do something great. You played against great teams, great players, and you handled them great.
You've been measured by this, by the way.
We'll show it to you right now.
You have to show
it.
I don't know
where again. We have it over here. You
want to
see the national team?
Yes.
No, we can. We also have like a few games from your playoff last year. From whatever you want. You have a personal report. Report like 5 games.
Hey, don't tell all the secrets.
My secrets? You have many games.
No, but show the national team. Show them how it looks like, the table.
Okay. Okay, let's try to do it. Put it in just.
How is it called?
Czech Republic. Okay.
National team.
Yeah, let's go with Czech Republic. Okay. For the game that we'll go. What was it? A friendly game?
Yeah.
Mundo Basket. One game specific or the all games?
Go to
trends. What do you want?
Brazil.
All everything?
Yeah.
Okay, but let's first of all make a gamble before we start on the personal level. Who was the highest VPM? Coach, can you gamble?
Pompey.
Have you seen Kreuz? How many times he bumped who was there? Number 50 from Brazil. That guy is crying now.
I must be honest with you. When Kreuz played, I didn't look because I was playing. Nothing will happen. That's the real thing.
Okay, so over here we just watch it game by game, value per minute, us compare the competition. We didn't start that good against US. Over here we won, so you can see it just in general. I don't want to go into too many details. But what we can learn right away, that we're talking about how many games, 5 games, let's say, away, 200 minutes, 205 actions. What you see over here in gold, it sum up all the blue, which is offense, and all the red action and arrows. Okay, but let's not make it complicated. Let's just go on a player average real quick. And who is it? Number 2.
He's not an average.
No, but he played like 2 minutes, I think. Like no, right? Something like that. Okay, so now you can see on a serious note, each and every player, how many games, how many minutes in average, how many action did he play. Why it's important? We track good players, good, really good players, making almost 2 action per minute, and some even more. That is the pace that we play, and a lot of players that do less than this, they're hiding from the game, like they're moving, but they're not making.
Well, it's a VPA, it's a total.
Okay, the total is blue and red together. The VPN, it's 1.4, okay, and then you see compared to the star, where you are compared to the team. So he was 120%, he was 99%, he was 94%, etc., etc. Now, how many points? Field goal made, percentage, free throws, and how many action on offense. And then, value per minute on offense. Now, what do we see? 0.54. Think like this. If there is 200 minutes a game, and I play alone, all the 200, and I score 0.5, which means I score 100 points. Good pace, no? So if someone is on 0.5, he's on a pace of a 100-point game. If I'm 0.6, I'm on a pace on 120. If I'm 0.7, 140, etc. If I'm 0.4, it's equal to 80 points per game. If I'm 0.6, it's equal to 60 points. Now, red action. Just some of this, we'll go deny, lose ball, contest, block shot, deflection, steal, steal and basket, defense, rebound, defense, transition, offense, rebound, transition, basket or assist or draw. All the actions over here, you come with all together. And then you have value per minute on red action. Good. Now, in the end of the day, coach will put it to you like this on the locker room. The white line is giving us our average, and then you can see it was just a little bit above average or low average in our team, and the blue line representing our opponent. Where we're our opponent, and sometimes we're not in our team average, but we're above our opponent. See, like above our opponent, significantly. Makes sense? It's
just every game we analyze like this, we also always analyze the opponent, so we always can compare.
We can analyze. Yes. Or just, let's see just one game, so you can focus on one thing.
The green dot is the minute.
What do you got, guys? Whoever played?
Turkey. USA.
USA. USA.
No, but
and then go to.
Turkey. Put Brazil, for example. Let's put Brazil and then Greece. And then Australia.
Brazil. Okay, we'll go over here again. Big game. Okay, so you can really see that you got them really down and you exploded. Very, very good game. Now, you can see, let's see if we can do that.
Hang on. Let's check the coach.
It's the same game.
I tell you, let's check the coach. Let's see who was in the...
on the court?
Make very good high-level VPM and the coach didn't use him. Maybe they could get a medal.
Exactly. But I want to show you something on a serious note. You see, on 200 minutes, the Czech did almost 180 action. Not the best game. But compared to Brazil, who did only 137, it's like 50 action more. And no one pay attention to it, but it's the tempo and the intensity. If I see only this, 95% of the time, I win the money if I bet on it. Because the amount of action can reflect to me your intensity and the energy that it was in. And then you can see on the red, which is really crucial, that you did 0.74, which is solid minus, and they were just terrible. almost 30% you were better than them. So even if they're more talented than you, in this gap, usually you will win. If you play against a better team and you break even in the red, probably we will lose. And this year, obviously, you will look on the paper, bigger team than you, and you will find a way to fuck them up. It's happened all the time, but now you can control it. So each and every one need to demand out of himself to lead the number of action in the team. What do I want? Different game? Something? Last one? Turkey?
How we can improve this?
The national team?
No, us. About this. But it's about how.
I think, first of all, we need to be aware of it, that we talk the same language. That the team goal is a first priority for everyone. If you're coming into a team sport, in the end of the day, the pack, the power of the pack, in and outside the court, is the most crucial thing. To control tempo and physical, it's the toughest thing to do in sport. And I think when players are aware of this, if coach is yelling at you, most of the time you will understand why. Because he wants you to play with high confidence. He pushes you all the time to think alone. Don't look at me. Think. Work. Control your confidence. Because when you have four or five players with confidence, usually good things will happen. And when we look to see if someone looking at us, already we know that we need it. Our confidence is low. So we need to be aware that it's moving all the time. And we need to be committed to this. It's very important not to cheat yourself. A lot of times, mentally or physically, we can't bring it on. It needs to be on the table with coach, with the coaching staff. That's part of the conversation. And I think that a strong team need to demand out of themselves the highest level. And you can feel it with amount of actions and the amount of, I don't want to say physical game, but aggressiveness. You see, like tempo coming easy, West Coast, then you're going East Coast, and then it becoming aggressive, and high aggressive, and high tempo. That's fair game. Above this, it's brutal game. This is not good. So to keep your mind and your focus, when your heart is high, and you're getting fouled, and to be composed, that's the trick in sport. So if you're aware of it, you're looking for it. Instead of being surprised that someone punches you and say, "Ah, you motherfucker, let's start," you're coming ahead of time. Now the secret of this is that you can't really pick it up if you didn't come ahead of time to fight. If before the game you're not coming to fight, and you're playing easy, and then it's tough to change it, because you're already full with cortisol. And to clear a body from cortisol and to enhance adrenaline, it's stupid. That's why we need to challenge ourselves physically. I like a lot in the locker room when people touching themselves physically, because it's scary. No one really wanted to get hurt. In every game, our ego wanted to play clean. Let's fuck them, let's go home. But then when the intensity is getting higher, we say, okay, let's increase it. I think the opposite. Every game, we should come on the top of the aggressiveness and the physical game. We will break their soul down, and then easy game. Maybe not.
It makes sense to have the list of the actions, so they can...
I think it is.
So they can know...
They can control it, they can improve it. It's easy to improve it.
No, but it's like you said, some guys are more let's say, skilled in touching balls and anticipate stuff. Some guys contested that. You don't understand that contest, if he didn't make the basket, it's a point. It's an action.
You're getting an action.
So we need to know it. That's what I'm saying, you know?
Yeah.
So we need to have some kind of the list, and so they understand what bring the points.
I'll give you the list, but let's think about it. Any action that you're doing and it's helping the score, I give you points. So the points come to three different levels. Deny, deflection, contest. A lot of the times we don't even touch the ball. We're just hurting the other side. We're getting points. If you make contest and you score, you don't get a point. But every time you make a strong peek, someone make a basket or assist, you get a point. Assist to assist, you get a point. Assist to free throw, you get a point. Lose ball,
okay, assist.
Point. Okay, stuff like that, give you 1 point. But then, if we having a possession, you're getting already 2 points. Deflection possession, 2 points. Lose ball possession, I throw the ball on someone, out for us, 2 points. And then, if we have high confidence, you can get 3 points. Steal, 2 points, possession. And basket, 3 points. Extra 2 points for the basket. And block shot, 1 point. If they are possession, block possession, 3 points. Block shot,
2 points. Block possession?
Yeah, but block and charge.
You give more?
I give more because it's breaking down mentally the shooters. Right? When you get a block, it's different than you just miss or contest. And charge, you get it for bravery. For me, it's a lot because when someone take a strong charge, the whole team getting androphinine. Everybody suddenly is like, there is a flash. If you use that 30, 40 seconds, you can start a momentum. What is a momentum in sport? Momentum is when 3, 4, or 5 guys together play with androphinine. Then you feel like 6 versus 5. You like killing them. But usually it's like 3, 4, 5 minutes and still the ego is start to increase and then it's falling down. So when there is a momentum coming up, I really like team not to celebrate. Just to keep pounding on it. When we're getting khaki, it's falling down because the ego is coming in. There is a huge game of Michael Jordan. He played against Cleveland. He scored 54 points. And he started to shoot from everywhere. And he wasn't a great shooter. He wasn't. But in that game, he shot everything. And then he turned to the fence.
I understand. What is not a great shooter?
Michael Jordan, all the way to 27, he had low percentage of 3 points.
Okay.
Low percentage, you can check it out. Low percentage, he was penetrating, and he was off court, and he worked hard on it. And not only that, before he was 28, he didn't have no championships. His first championship was when he was 28. He scored billion points, but in that game against Cleveland, he shoot from everywhere. And then he turned to the fence like this. He just walked.
Portland.
Against?
Portland.
Portland? I think Cleveland. I will check it out.
7 degrees. I'm a master in Jordan.
You master in Jordan? First championship when he was 28. He was a Guido before. Check it out. But he did like this, and then he used to talk about
it. I was a teenager. I asked Julia Roberts or Jordan, I go Jordan.
Anyway, he talked about it, that he was looking at the fence, and he was like, no one can guard. And in that moment, that was his last shot that went in. You know, sometimes when you feel, you start want to talk about it, that's the end of it. So for me, to keep a good momentum is to feel it, to know it happened, and to keep pounding on it. Coach?
To end it. See the from the 6 games from last season.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, sure,
go for
Nimrod with KB.
Yeah.
Nimrod. 2000.
Okay, you got it. Second?
Yes, yeah. You need to change it to ERA if you don't want to get fined.
Yeah.
Go Champions League.
Champion League what?
Champions League 2000.
Okay, all on the bottom. Okay. What game?
All
game? Okay.
Now press on players. Yeah, press on it again so you can see it. Yeah.
No, delete that tabla. Give me this.
Go one before, player average.
Put it up.
Go up a little bit. Yeah.
So what we have here?
More. Just okay. Over here.
Six games.
Yeah, but over here you can see that you did 232 actions. Very high tempo. Very high tempo.
Because
very
we pick up the best player again.
Compared to
yeah,
the 219. So it's usually like 13 action more. Now over here you have all games, right?
No. Now we have only this because we picked up. Show me. Go player by player. Just to have the.
Oh, okay, over here you have all the players.
Yeah,
all the players.
Vojta. 1.2.
No, 1.4. 1.4.
So this is a stud.
Yeah.
Vojta, you are a stud. Or not?
1.35. Below him.
So how many actions?
So it's Gino 1.35. Yeah. Bocci. This Peter Benda.
Where's Benda?
Benda and
Benda. They always give you my care too. Always. Even in the
after Benjamin, we talk so high on you, you give me minus. Anyway, it's a good
way for them.
Okay, I now put all the cards out.
Okay.
In the end, they're judging me. Because the team...
Exactly. Well, I didn't want to say it, but...
Say it.
Okay, so... When you see the team on the bottom... In our program, not when I'm selling it to you, it's said over here, Coach Amiel versus Coach whatever. And then I know if Coach Amiel is tough, if he's playing strong, if he's playing a lot, if his value, red value per minute, is high. 0.95, solid, you're getting it to 1-1, studs. And...
In the table you're going to get, you're not going to see the coach.
No, we're not going to see the coach. It's the team.
No, the coach never... The idea is that to see if we can use, let's say, the guys were in this game especially, In the, what you say?
Tempo?
Yeah. The right guy, let's say.
Sometimes you say, listen, if it's a big game and we need to win, you can put a team goal. Guys, we need 200 actions. Take responsibility over it. In the end of the day, coaches yell as much as he wants.
But we play Bamberg. You have Bamberg there? Put Bamberg.
Like Bamberg, huh?
Yeah.
Because we beat them. For the
no, I just want to because this is question I asked before. Okay, we play Bamberg. We beat them in the red
action.
We
don't have Bamberg.
We should have.
First one.
Yeah. Okay.
Go to okay.
If I remember, we beat them in red action.
Red actions.
No. Or even if in the total.
Okay. No. Go to the first one. Yeah. Okay. Over here we watch the game. So you see, 122 versus 123. Right. It was a break-even game. No. Now you want to watch the red action.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. I can see it over here right away.
Yeah.
Right. Let's go.
Go. Put it up.
Yeah.
It's like this.
Okay. So you see opponent and team. So the opponent did 188.
You did
109. 102.
So how we lost?
What do you mean how you lost? You did 21 arrows. You did 21 arrows compared to 16. Right?
Mm-hmm.
You see? Yeah. So it's like
how
five.
How was the game finished?
How the game finished?
7 points.
7 points difference.
Basically, their talent beat us.
Yeah. If we break even. Yeah.
So in this, when we come to play against, when we are underdog,
you underdog,
We need to have to know what we
did. Usually 15%, 10-15% more action. Yeah.
It's doable because usually favorites don't like to fight. Favorites want to fuck it over.
Yeah, let's pass, let's kill and go home.
When you play against 90% of the league games, they're coming in, they're going to have to kill the game, and let's go home. And then you come in, someone fight, it's tough to fight back. Because you're already frozen and they're already excited. So even if you bet, so if you underdog, in my opinion, like the Czech did it in the national, but a lot, you come in extremely strong in the beginning, and if you can freeze them, it's a different game, only today. Like Maccabi did to Real, only for today. After that, they take you seriously, they come to fight them on. But what you're trying to do over here, it's tough to get ready for it. Because you practice fast and strong, fast and strong, fast and strong, and everybody in. It's tough to match it. I hope this team can come to 220, 230 action, and then it's...
All this methodics, it's not like from the sky. It's I just want them to know that behind this there is like I don't know how many games you...
100 of games.
100 of games, yeah. From all levels.
I can show you Cleveland.
That was like measure and research final, and guess all these conclusions.
Man, it's just working. That's the way it is. Pumping something to close it up. Now you understand why everybody loves you, even that you score 4 points?
I made my whole career.
He talked about it.
Yeah, but it's important because some guys are natural there.
Yes.
And some guys not, but they can be better than where they are.
Exactly. That's why I show blue.
No,
for Ruben. Right, like there's players, the great shooter, they usually don't get there until they get into it. But when they get into it, it's...
He was 1.4, I have done less than
106. Yeah, but that's a team, you know, that's a team. If we have it in a system, it's working.
Boy, you're just thinking in an hour, man.
What? What?
I don't know, I'm just wondering what the... Yeah, like how you said, we need to know the things. Yeah.
No, I'm thinking this is a development of the... This is, we're going to get percentage for this.
Yes.
No, seriously.
No, I have a list.
No, we need a list.
I have a list.
So they have the idea for what they, you know,
what they get
encourage them
for.
To go.
Yeah.
Because if you contest for a shot and he got scored, you don't get points. If you contest and he missed, you get points. But if you don't contest and he missed, you don't get points. This is something to know.
But I mean, I'm thinking also about the second side. You don't want to go like overboard with it because okay. You don't want to over-contest every shot just to get points. You don't want to jump and try to block
every
shot.
No, you don't. No, because but if you make the foul, you lose points.
Let's talk about the minuses. Blow by.
Everybody know what is blow by?
When someone take you over and get to the line.
Straight line.
I jump you jump, and I score, blow by. So, all the 5 points you make, you lost them in one stupid move. Overpowering. Someone overpowering you all the way to the basket, you get killed. You have 5 fouls, each one of you, to sacrifice for the team. If you weaken defense and you can't do shit, stop it, but no easy basket. It's unbelievable that 4 people guarding and then someone coming in. So there is minuses and you need to be smart and actually it's just to improve your confidence. It's not to decrease your confidence. It's just a confidence tool. It's a psychophysiology tool to control your confidence. And when your confidence is high, your decisions and your performance is higher. Make sense?
That's why it's not about go to a psychologist and underestimate nobody, but to lie on the couch and talk about, you know, this is measured. This is why I related to things that are measured. If you don't have something to measure, for me, it's like, I don't know what is self-confidence. I really don't understand what is Lewis confidence.
Yeah.
You know, we all say it sometimes, but it's basically, it's what it means, plain confidence.
So what we mean, and a lot of times we say, let's go back to the basics. What are the basics?
Yeah.
Let's guard one-on-one, let's push our body, let's close together. No.
we mean that. And why? Because it gives us possessions and it gives us confidence, and that's all fine. Now, a lot of times our mind is moving to different places, and it's just to get us together, to be on the same page all the time. You know, like Detroit Pistons used to live back in the days, like they really got like tough, and then Chicago, and all the way to all the champions. When Coach Blatt was in Cleveland, we tried to send them a few reports against Golden State, which is, Golden State is a weird team because it's like kind of like a 10, 12 players, pretty much average. But the biggest strength was the bench players. They used to come 15, 20 minutes in the beginning, and they were just tremendous. And LeBron, in his first game, scored 44 points. But on the red action, he was only break even. No confidence. He scored points, but he was not with high confidence. Last shot of the game, with no confidence, you will go to a shot, what people will think of me. When you have high confidence, you go for the basket. So LeBron take a fadeaway from the corner three. Fadeaway with a player. Now, if he make it, he's a god. And if he miss it, what can I do? Tough shot. Let's go back to Michael. Never, ever, ever. Michael never, ever took last winning shot.
Utah Jazz?
Leaning forward?
What did he
do? Utah Jazz, we took him all the way to the baseline, not fade away from the three.
No, but it's pull up.
Facing forward, stepping into the basket like you're teaching the kid.
I wanted to see.
No, I just want to make twice in a row. But Michael will never take a shot that he's not believing in the percentage.
Okay, Michael.
Why? No, because when you play with confidence, you play to win. And when you don't have confidence, and that's killed. Cleveland.
No, for you guys that still think LeBron is in the same level of Michael, yeah?
No.
Or Kobe, or this.
No, right?
Okay,
cool.
Alright. Okay, anyway.
Yeah.
That's pretty much it. I wanna end it over here because I don't want too much with it. I'm gonna be over it all week. It's gonna be open. If on individual you wanna see yourself, you wanna talk about it, you wanna check it, let's talk about it.
We're going to measure these two games also.
Tomorrow?
Tomorrow and the day after.
And the day after.
And we're going to get the result hopefully 24 hours after.
Yeah.
And
we'll talk about it, we'll improve it, we'll make it a conversation. That's
it.
Yeah.
Okay, good night.
Thank you guys.